Hi guys, I'm Kumar Shubham and I work as a data engineer at DataView, a company that provides competitive intelligence as a service to brands and retailers. At DataView, we crawl millions of products across different e-commerce sites and match them to provide competitive insights to our clients. For example, an online fashion retailer might require consumable information about pricing of certain products listed across their competitors. How often the prices varies, or what sort of discounts are being provided, and are this product even promoted by their competitors. To provide this kind of information, you first need to identify those products and match them across different e-commerce sites. Typically, text-based information like titles and descriptions are used to do a product matching. But when you come to the fashion vertical, these titles and descriptions are not detailed enough to capture all sort of variations. For example, at Myntra, you can have more than 1,000 products with name white check collar shirt. So we use deep learning algorithms to do image matching in fashion vertical. So what is image matching? Given millions of products listed across different e-commerce sites, finding product which basically shares similar and exactly same looking images to given seed image. If you look into the overall image matching process, it can be divided into two subcategories. Identifying the semantics and categorical attributes which are associated with an image. Semantic attributes like what type of sleeves is it, or what type of neck type is present on a given image. Categorical aspects of an image, like whether it belongs to Batman category or whether it belongs to Superman category. And apart from that, there are some fine level and minute grained feature which is associated with an image, which this deep learning, semantics and categorical attributes fail to capture. For example, how two striped shirts are different, or what are the difference between two graphic shirts, or how are two floral shirts different from each other. With recent development in deep learning, the deep learning architecture are working fine in capturing this variation associated with an image. So if you look into the present architecture, how people are doing image matching, they generally train a deep learning model to identify both this semantic and categorical aspects related to an image, and at the same time identifying the fine level features which are associated with an image. But compared to having a deep learning model or deep learning architecture like AlexNet and Inception or VGGNet, and extracting these fine level features capturing these fine level attributes, developing a model to capture all type of semantics attributes which is going to be associated with an image, is both complex and expensive. Complex in the sense that here we are basically planning to have a model which knows all type of patterns, all type of sleeves, and all type of neck type which is associated with an image, and that too on a very large scale. While most of the people can afford big GPUs clusters, but generating training data set is still hard, and even the accuracy of such model is questionable. Because here we are planning to capture all sort of variation which is present across geography and replicate that in your training data set. One thing which is unique when you work with e-commerce site is the availability of a lot of titles and description associated with a given product. So at DataView, we asked ourselves that can we use these titles and descriptions along with the deep learning feature to boost our image matching capability in fashion vertical. And the solution we arrived at was Solr. An open source enterprise searching platform which is well known for its NLP capability. Like any big data search engine platform, it provides you real-time indexing mechanism in the fault tolerance. Solr is a standalone full-text search server and which is powered by Lucene libraries, and it provides you REST-like APIs for most of its query over its database. So first off, how we are going to use Solr, which is meant for natural language processing, and store deep learning features into it. So we extracted the final layer feature vector from AlexNet Inception and VGGNet and indexed it as a multi-value numeric list. Now while indexing, we also wanted to group products which basically share similar looking images in terms of deep learning features. So there's two reasons for doing that. First, we wanted to save some types in the complex re-ranking process which I am going to discuss in the later stage. And at the same time, we wanted to develop a variable field to group similar looking product together. So one data structure will basically solve this problem as hash function. So We started experimenting with different hash function which is known to take numerical feature vectors as an input and group similar looking products like local sensitive hashing, kernelized local sensitive hashing per image and self.hashing. If you look local sensitive hashing and kernelized local sensitive hashing, they tries to group product by dividing the very high dimensional feature space into multiple buckets. Self.hashing is unique in the sense that it uses a collaboration of both supervised and unsupervised algorithms. If you look into the slide, for a given corpus, there's an unsupervised mechanism to understand the possible hash bits which is going to be associated with the given document. And then we have a supervised mechanism to learn the mapping process from the given document corpus to this hash bits. Once we have trained this model, this new model can be used as a hash function for any upcoming new documents. So for our use case, self.hashing works best, and we index these self.hash bits along with deep learning features and textual descriptions into Solr. So why self.hashing? Self.hashing is a unique semantic hashing. Semantic hashing in the sense that we want to create bucket of products which basically share similar semantic attributes. For example, you can have a bucket of similar looking t-shirts and a completely different bucket for shoes and slippers. Self.hashing provides you more control over your hash function generation. So here you explicitly define the neighborhoods for a given product. While doing the binarized elaboration, I can map decomposition to generate the hash bits. And since a machine learning algorithm is involved, you can expect that similar looking image features will be mapped to the same hash bucket. Once we have indexed the whole textual description, deep learning features and the corresponding self.hash bits, we wanted to develop a proper searching mechanism over the index dataset. For the given task, we needed a new request handler, which is going to handle all the upcoming requests. So whenever a request comes, we create a bucket of similar looking product based on the hash bounds of across the self.hash bits which we already have indexed. Now we narrow down that bucket to a small subset of required documents based on the titles, based on the attributes extracted from titles and descriptions. For example, you can explicitly ask the white, check and color to be mentioned in your document. Once you have narrowed down your subset, you re-rank them based on the deep learning feature which is already indexed in your database with the seed image on the over the queries made. One unique thing with the present mechanism is there is a tight coupling of stored data set and the algorithm. So instead of bringing the data from one server to another, we have moved the whole computation engine to the data itself. So we are saving a lot of latency time which is going to be associated when you want to fetch the data of a deep learning features which is going to be 2048 double list. So now I want to show you some example where that this text-based mechanism and image matching helps us. So for example, for given Batman seed search, if you go completely for image matching, you might land up into a Superman shirt, which look too much same to your seed image. While doing a proper text matching, you might land up into a product, which basically belong to Batman category, but share completely different image. It might be possible that a Batman as a human is present on that image. But when you have this collaboration of both text and image, you land up into an exactly same looking product. Similarly, there can be a denim shirt where the defining attribute is basically stars. While doing an image matching, you might land up into a denim shirt which look too much similar to your seed image. And a text matching might land up you into products where these attributes is present, but the image look completely different. But with both as a mechanism, you land up into an exactly same looking product. So, following is a sample request call to the select request handler which comes with the Solr. So, as you can see in the query report, I've made a call for Batmans and Black to be mentioned in the title and some basic filters across MRP. In the response section, that scores are not normalized, so you don't know that how much similar this product is with the given seed query. And also, by looking into the titles, you can't make a decisive decision about which product is similar or how much it's going to be similar. Similarly, this is something through our mechanism which we have developed. So here we made a query over the URL which is a unique identifier for the given product, and we have defined few basic filters on the MRPs and a deep learning cutoff that the overall computation should be at least this much number. As you can see, that although we are getting similar documents, and this score is basically a normalized one when we compare the candidate with the seat, but still there is a scope of filtering in the sense that I might not require the Batman and Superman to be mentioned in the title. In the second, in the last, so here you can see that I have explicitly asked Batman and the Black to be mentioned in the title, and the HL and HU is the hash bounds which we want upon the image hash which has been indexed. So here it's 0 to 4. Similarly, there is a filters upon the price, and the DLC is basically deep learning cutoff. That at least the deep learning, the cosine similarity which is going to be done on the indexed candidates and the seed image should be at least this much similar. And as you can see, the in the response part, this Black and Batman is mentioned in the title. And similarly, the scores basically give you an idea that how much similar this candidate is with the seed. So, yeah. Any questions?
If anyone has a question, please raise your hand. A couple hands raised over here too. We don't have a lot of time for questions. We may only have time for one or two.
Okay, so my question is, have you tried a float training approach to this? Because it involves having different views.
Exactly.
I was wondering if you
Go training. Okay, so we haven't tried it yet, but we will experiment. Deep features alone. Okay, so if you see the overall process, we basically index the subset which we want to search upon, and also that seed image. So that seed URL, if you see in the slide, seed URL is a unique identifier for that given URL which we want to see, search upon. Internally, we fetch the deep learning features, and based on the hash bound, we know that these are the possible candidates which is going to be close to the given seed. And we do a cosine similarity across the seed deep learning features and the candidate ones. Okay, so while indexing itself, so what we have done, we pass the image to this deep learning architecture, and we extracted the deep learning features from this final layer. Yeah. So if you see in the present mechanism, obviously you can't go with an ONS search on whatever data set you have. So there's a self-taught hash mechanism also. So what we do, for any given seed image, we first find out the possible search bucket, that this many images are going to be most similar to your seed. And then we re-rank them. We rank them that among this 10 or 20 documents which is in your given bucket, which one is the most similar one. And you can, the unique thing here is that you can even refine that bucket. You can ask that, look, if 200 for a product has come into your bucket, I want these attributes to be present in the title or description. So you can narrow down that subset. And finally, you have that document you can rerun. What we basically do that before finding the hash bits and before extracting this deep learning feature, we do a set of pre-processing on image itself. We remove the background. We identify that, look, if the product is basically t-shirts, just focus upon the t-shirt part only. Okay. And then we extract these deep learning features. So a lot of pre-processing is going on in behind before the deep learning and hash bit has been extracted. No, it's not necessary. So what we do, we identify the, if suppose two person is basically present in a given image. We basically identify the person itself. We identify the clothing part and we extract these images separately. We have an object detection mechanism which basically gives a score that how much confident the model is for a given clothing part. So we can index both of these features together in that into Solr.
Hello, you actually talked about that hashing technique.
Yeah.
What kind of function, that the hashing function you used for that? Did you use a single hashing function or a set of hashing function?
Okay, so in our use case, the hashing functions need to group the similar looking product into a similar bucket. So one of the possible hash function which is well known for this purpose is local sensitive hashing. And kernelized local sensitive hashing. But the problem which comes with the local sensitive and kernelized local sensitive hashing is that you don't have much control on the hash function generations. And we needed some mechanism where the features, the correlation between the deep learning feature, we can basically preserve. So that's why we went with the self-taught hashing. That's the basically algorithm which is doing this. Yeah. Yeah, sure. Okay, the hash is not just a filter which is going to work on your document. We have basically multiple filters based developed on the text and the description. For example, while planning to find an exact looking product, you are basically interested in the same color products, and that you can easily find from the text and descriptions which are present, because most of the time on e-commerce sites these attributes is going to be present. So generally we go with a higher recall system with the self-taught hashing system mechanism. We want 90% of the 90% or 92% of recall, at least in the self-taught hash bits. Then we narrow it down that if more there's 2000 or 3000 products which is present in your bucket, we filter those products where the black or blue is not mentioned. So once you have a small subset, then you can re-rank them, because re-ranking is going to be a very computational expensive problem.
First of all, what is the URL edge? Can you explain it a bit more?
Okay.
And the HU and the HL part. And why Solr? Why Solr? Because you are using OSM directly, right? Is there something special about Solr, or you can also do it?
Yeah.
With that.
Sir, just one question, please. We have like 1 minute left.
How do you measure the accuracy? Like, how do you measure the improvement if you are improving? How do you measure that you are improving?
Okay. Yeah. So URL is basically a unique identifier for that product. It can be hash value of the URL edge or hash value of any unique identifier for that product. HL and HU is the lower hash bound and the upper hash bound which you basically want to be into the product. So in terms of improving, Solr. One thing why we went with the Solr is that Solr, the text-based mechanism or the text-based NLP capability which we wanted, Solr basically provide all of this functionality for you. So we haven't experimented with Elasticsearch, but I think that the present mechanism can be implemented in that also. Yeah. Okay, the accuracy. So if you look into our company, we have a human in the loop process. So what we basically do, we find out a small subset of documents and we show it to the human. And they have the capability to basically search through the whole database. So you based on the attributes which they think that it's a unique identifier for that given product. And once they identify that the product is exact matching, they choose that. So using human in the loop, we basically reach more than 90%.
I think you might need to take this offline if you have another talk coming up. And I'm just getting it set up now. So thank you very much.
Yeah.
I think next time we're going to have to book you in for a slightly longer session.